greetings from Caroline County, Virginia, and welcome to Wright's Chapel. My name is Tanya, and I'm the Director of Connection Ministries. Thank you for worshiping with us today. If you haven't already, we'd like to ask you to type in your name and the name of those worshiping with you in the comments section. This is also a great opportunity to greet one another and to say hello to those who may be new to online worship. If you're worshiping with us at a later time or day, please visit our website, WrightsChapel.org, to let us know of your attendance. As always, if you have questions about Wright's Chapel or you'd like to learn more about our ministry, feel free to reach out to me directly at Tanya@WrightsChapel.org, or you may call or text me at 540-604-0038. Thanks so much for worshiping with us, and may God bless you as Clay leads us into a song of praise.
Hi, I'm Clay Motley, the music director here at Wright's Chapel, and I'm inviting you to join us as we sing these songs here. Wherever you find yourself, join us, sing along, sing out loud, do the claps, dance, whatever you need to do to stay as if you are here in person with us. We'd love for you to join us with us. Come on.
Welcome to Wright's Chapel. It is so good to be in worship with you. My name is Charles. I'm pastor here at Wright's Chapel, and I thank you for taking time to be in worship. As you draw near to God, as God draws near to you, I pray that you feel God's presence in this time of worship, whenever it is that you are worshiping with us. We are actually at my dad's house. This is where I and my family and my dad spent the last several days during the storm this week, and we hunkered down here in this little room, and we came over here because my dad has a gas fireplace, but as you might be able to see, it's not working now, and it didn't work during the storm. We couldn't figure out how to get it going. And that's one of my lessons about preparedness in my sermon that you'll hear in just a little bit about how we need to be prepared. But this is where we're at this day for worship in my dad's house. And pray that you will relate and find a connection to God as we talk about lessons from the winter storm this morning. If you haven't already, we hope that you'll check in and let us know that you're worshiping with us and that you'll share the names of any of those who are worshiping with you in the room with you today. If you see somebody who has checked in and want to welcome them into worship, hope that you'll comment and welcome them and give them a good morning or afternoon, whenever that is you're worshiping. If you have any prayer requests, as we get ready to move into a time of prayer, if you have any prayer requests, I hope that you'll share those with us. Let's continue to keep those who are stranded and stuck without power and homes. And some of those are our own church folks, our church family, we know are still some without power. Keep them in our prayers, as many of us have been through that and just know what a miserable time that is. Let us then prepare to go to God in prayers and share those prayer requests that you might have in the comment section as well.
I'm Gloria Abrams. Let us pray. Gracious and merciful God, you know us and you love us. You have called us to be your followers, and we ask you today to help us to answer that call, not with lip service only, but with all our lives. The path that Jesus calls us to follow doesn't promise to be easy, but Jesus tells us to be ready to take up our cross and follow him. But we also know that following Jesus will ultimately lead to the more abundant life. We ask God that you remove all fear and doubt from our minds. Help us to see each person we meet as your precious child. For too often we look upon others' outward appearance and only give honor to those who we meet the world standards of success. Forgive us, Lord, for not being able to fully see all that you have created. We love you, God, and we want to follow you. Fill us with your Holy Spirit so that we may take your words of faith and turn them into acts of mercy. Use us to speak a word of healing to those who are possessed by pain. May your power release those who are imprisoned in a world of inner turmoil. Fill us with hope that we might proclaim your glory and goodness to all the world. We thank you for using us to further your kingdom. May we answer your call with obedience, and may you answer our prayers and bless us with peace. We pray this day in the name of Jesus the Christ, who taught us when to pray to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I'm Renee Womack, reading Luke chapter 10, the parable of the Good Samaritan. Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, what is written in the law? What do you read there? He answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, you have given the right answer. Do this and you will live. But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho and fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise, a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper, and said, take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you should spend. Which of these 3 do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of the robbery? He said, the one who showed him mercy. Jesus said to him, go and do likewise.
Let's then pray together. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts truly be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. So, the Western Caroline County Supervisor, Jeff Black, posted this week on Facebook that that Rappahannock Electric Co-op listed this week's winter storm among the top 5 storms that they have ever had to deal with. Downed trees and power outages, the snow, the cold, drivers stranded. Some folks we know are still without power. God bless them. God bless them. And that. I don't know how far back Rappahannock Electric goes in ranking storms, but some of us who have lived here a while can remember the hurricane of 2003. Some can remember the ice storm of 1995. And perhaps, depending upon your present circumstance, your present situation, this one that we just came through will rank right alongside of them. I'm curious where some of you would rank this storm as compared to others that you've been in. Maybe you faced another storm in a different part of the country. How did this one stack up for you? Was this the worst ever for you? Was this a real messy inconvenience for you, or was this one more like, this was just a piece of cake? This was no big deal for you. And I realize that for some of you, we'll take this into consideration, that your ranking may depend on whether you've been able to get a hot shower yet or not. I realize that. But go ahead if you want and rank this storm in the comment section of where you might rank this and how you would rank it. We lost our family, my family, we lost power on Monday around noon. We ended up getting it back on Wednesday about 1 or so. And I got to tell you, looking back, I know it was only 48. It was only 48 hours. And others of you struggled without power for so much longer. And some of you, I know, are still suffering in that. But boy, can I tell you, even 48 hours seems so much longer while you were in the midst of it. Wednesday at about 2 o'clock in the morning, while I was lying right over here on the couch, I was wide awake under a pile of blankets at my dad's house, and I thought, I was awake and I couldn't sleep, and I thought, this sucks. And then the thought crossed my mind. It did at 2 a.m. What if we never get power back? It made me think of my friends in Haiti, who live every day never knowing whether there will be power or not. And can I tell you, it made me thankful that you all paid to have solar panels installed on the home that you built in Haiti for disabled women, so that those young women would have a constant source of power. Well, some of you are aware that I was planning on starting a new worship series this morning on the Lord's Prayer. But in light of this week's stormy events, I've decided instead to delay that and start that series next week. Also next week, we'll be doing new members joining. And so if that is something that you're interested in joining the church, you can do that online or you can do that in person. Just let us know. You can write that into the comment section. If you'd be interested in joining, we'd be getting with you. But we're having a lot of people join church next Sunday. But today, rather than talk about the Lord's Prayer, I thought that I'd share some lessons, some biblical maybe and spiritual lessons I learned this week from this winter storm. And can I tell you that some of those lessons came to me during that 2 a.m. hour when I couldn't sleep. And truthfully, it wasn't that I was so worried and it wasn't that I was so upset. But like some of you, it was more that I had gone to bed like at 7 o'clock that night because it was dark and there was nothing to do. And so I was just at that time done with sleep and I was just wide awake and was just up thinking. So when I start thinking of the lessons I've learned, one of the things I've heard people say, and certainly that I thought was, where was the buildup to this storm? It was as if this storm caught so many of us unprepared. Usually in Virginia, the local weather folks will be all over a storm like this for days and days before. They will have looked at 273 different storm forecast models, and they will have projections of when and where and how much snow will be falling hour by hour. They will be doing news broadcasts from the VDOT stations, talking to road crews who will be going out. And I got, maybe I missed it, but I just don't remember hearing that much about this storm. It was like it even caught the weather forecasters totally unprepared. A lot of us, I think, were unprepared for the severity of the storm. Church Secretary Connie was telling me that the number one request, as she was answering the phone, the number one request we got as a church was folks who were calling for wood. And it wasn't our regular clients that our lumberjacks supply who were calling. We had them well stocked. It was just random folks who got caught unprepared without wood for their fireplace or for their wood stove. I got laughing at Sean, our youth, our missions coordinator, and how unprepared he was. Some of you know Sean has been borrowing his friend's big four-wheel drive truck for a few weeks now as he's getting some work done on his house. And as the snow was piling up on Monday morning, I was thinking, well, Sean, he won't be having any problem getting out in this snow. He's got Bill's truck. But when I asked Sean if he was getting out, Sean, he was so frustrated with himself. No, he said. I parked our two cars in front of the truck, and now I can't move the car, so I can't get the truck out. I am so unprepared for this storm, he said. And then it was the same frustration when Sean went to try and use his grill after they had lost power on that Monday afternoon. Sean was going to grill up some chicken and fix his wife and kids a nice warm meal that first night. But he ran out of gas in his propane tank halfway through grilling, and he couldn't get his truck out to get any more gas. Well, a lot of folks I know would feel sorry for Sean. Me, being his friend, I laughed and thought, I could use that in a sermon. It reminded me of the story that Jesus told in Matthew's gospel about the foolish bridesmaids who ran out of oil in their lamps as they waited for the wedding to start. There are actually several lessons that Jesus tells right in a row in this section of Matthew's gospel, where Jesus is talking about the importance of being prepared. Keep awake, therefore, says Jesus, be prepared, for you do not know on what day your Lord is coming. If the owner of the house had known what time the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would have not let his house be broken into. Therefore, you must be ready. Well, obviously, in those scripture passages, Jesus is not talking about having our propane tanks filled so that we can use our grill, nor is he talking about having wood stacked in your yard. But Jesus is talking about the importance of being spiritually prepared to face the storms that come to us in life. This storm at the beginning of the new year is perhaps a good reminder and a lesson of the importance of spiritual preparedness to face the storms of life. I can tell you as a preacher for more than 30 years that storms, much more severe than this recent snowstorm, are going to hit us all in life. And the storms I'm talking about may not hit all of us at the same time. And there will even be those times when it may feel like the storm is directed only at you. There will be the sudden death of a loved one. There will be a job loss. There will be a medical diagnosis you hadn't expected. Your marriage, your relationship will hit a really rough patch. One of your kids will go prodigal on you. Life can get really tough, really fast, and it sends us into a shock. And once we get through the shock, the question is, are we prepared to deal with the storm? Part of our preparedness is the spiritual preparedness of having that solid foundation of where we can lay down our burdens. Have we prepared for the storm by being a part of a faith community where we have developed relationships with people who can help carry us through that storm? Have we prepared our own hearts for the storm through prayer and through worship, through the reading of Scripture, all so that we can live with the assurance and that we can live with the confidence that we can weather any storm that may come? Have we prepared to grow our faith, to grow our hope, so that we are ready to walk through any storm that might come? I can tell you as a pastor who has been doing this job a long time, when I walk into a family room or into a hospital room or into a funeral home or into a courtroom, it often becomes very apparent who has done the daily, who has done the weekly spiritual preparedness so that they can weather the storm that came upon them so quickly. A good reminder and a lesson from this storm: be prepared. In life, it can be such a huge help if we are prepared. And that includes being spiritually prepared and knowing who we can call upon. I think about that famous hymn, "When the storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the storms of life are raging, stand by me. When the world is tossing me like a ship upon the sea, Thou who rulest wind and water, stand by me." So one of the things, I heard from folks as we waited for the power to come on, one of the things I kept hearing from folks is that they were bored. Can I tell you, we were bored too. We tried to keep busy. Lydia and Grandpa were doing a puzzle. Amy was fine reading. My daughter Sophia, who's disabled, she was putting things on people's head and she was having a great time. I was just bored. I'd shoveled the driveway and then I was like, well, we don't have internet and no TV. I'm terrible at puzzles. But I had charged up my phone in the car so I could text and I could get on Facebook on my phone and so I spent a good amount of time just texting and then scrolling Facebook looking to see who didn't have power and who was getting power, who had no hope of getting power. And can I tell you, there were several things that struck me as I looked at social media. And one of them was the kindness that was being offered. Lots of folks were offering to do kind things. Lots of folks offering to open their homes, even to strangers, right? Fixing meals, offering to get gas, drive folks to appointments. One family I saw picked up 20 pizzas and were willing to deliver them to families who needed a hot meal. And I thought, boy, that's really nice. That's kind. That was nice to see. The other thing I saw on social media was people putting out requests on Facebook. Can someone get us something at the store? Can someone help? We need this. We need that. Can someone help do this? Can someone help do that? It was just random requests for help that some people made on social media. And I got to tell you, my initial thought was that this is so sad. Do they not know anyone that they can specifically ask for help? They have no connections with anyone that they can call. Even if they have no family, they have no friend, no neighbor that they know by name. They are left to send out a random call for help on Facebook. Last week in his sermon, Bob Goff talked about the importance of building relationships as a part of our faith life. And can I tell you, that was a lesson that was so reinforced to me this past week. And I got to tell you, I thought it was very nice of folks to open up their home to complete strangers. I just wonder how many folks took them up on that request. I thought it was so nice to offer up a hot meal to complete strangers. I just wonder how many folks took them up on that request. What I heard and saw on Facebook more and more, though, is that people who had relationships, neighbors who already knew each other, were helping each other out. Neely hung over at the Williams with Michelle. The Kigers spent the night at the Carlsons, who had a heated basement. Cassidy spent the night and got a shower at Molly's. Kay got hot coffee down at Kim's. I went over to Ron Burris's and heated up some soup for my dad and myself for supper on Ron's gas stove. Neighbors who already knew each other were more comfortable receiving help from one another. Now, even if you've never read any of the Bible, you probably know the story that Jesus tells of the Good Samaritan. Renee read that for us. You remember the poor guy is beaten, robbed, left for half dead on the road, and a stranger, a Samaritan, right, comes along and helps him and cares for him. And Jesus uses this story to talk about the good that we do for our neighbor. And probably most of us would do that, right? we would want to be the good Samaritan for someone, and most of us probably we would receive and be thankful for the help from a good Samaritan if our circumstances were that bad and we had been left for half dead. I read about the guy in the bread truck, right? Some of you heard this story and posted it, who started passing out bread on Interstate 95 to all those stranded drivers. That was really nice. That was a good Samaritan act. But what about when it's not life and death? And it's rather more about convenience and being helpful and being nice. Doesn't it feel different receiving help when it's simply about convenience and there's no genuine relationship? Most of us, I suspect, we don't want to put strangers out for mere convenience. But with friends, it's different. And we'll receive help from friends because there's already a relationship. I'd have to admit to y'all that I can't tell you much about my neighbors. I think about the five houses on either side of mine, the houses across from me. I couldn't tell you the names of most of the people who live there. I couldn't tell you what they do. I couldn't tell you if they have kids or if they don't. But I think about this story, and what if Jesus, when he talked about who was a good neighbor, what if Jesus really wanted us to help our neighbors? What if Jesus is talking about those people who live right around us? Now in my case, Ron and Marge Burris are one of my neighbors, and I know them, and I know them because they are church folks. But I'm pretty sure that wasn't the criteria of Jesus. Jesus never asked, do they go to your church? And so this storm got me to asking, do you know your neighbors, Charles? And in most instances, I don't. I wonder about you. Could you name the folks who live five houses on either side of you, across from you? And this has nothing to do with getting folks to come to church. And yet maybe it has everything to do with how Jesus would want us to live and how Jesus would want us to build relationships with and care about people who live closest to us, our neighbors. One of the lessons I got from this storm is that maybe we can be better followers of Jesus by simply reaching out and getting to know our neighbors. And again, it has nothing to do with getting them to come to church. If eventually they come, great. But maybe being a good neighbor is also about first just building a relationship with those who live by us and who live around us, so that when the storm comes, our offers of hospitality and our sharing the love of Christ may actually make a real impact. If we have an actual relationship with the folks who live by us, they may actually come and stay at our place. They may actually take us up on our offer of a hot meal. And so how do we be neighborly? And in doing so, share the love of Jesus. And what I know is it starts by spending time to build a relationship. And this is I know is really hard for some of us introverts. I know it is. And it's especially hard now in the midst of COVID. But this storm taught me a lesson. And so I'm going to make an effort to be a better neighbor. And maybe I'll start with something simple like Sophia's Sweets and get some cookies to break the ice and just deliver them and start to get to know my neighbors. And I'd love to hear your thoughts of what you will do to get to know your neighbors or what you've done and how you've started a relationship with those who live closest to you. And if you've got ideas about how to be a better neighbor, go ahead. And I want you to just type those into the comment section if you have it. So there were lots of lessons from the storm, but I'll share one final lesson with you and that this storm taught me. And I was laying on the couch. I was reminded of this passage of scripture from Psalm 46. The psalmist starts off by writing, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change, though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though the waters roars and the foam, and the and then the psalmist ends that psalm by saying, be still and know that I am God. Well, it was obvious that by Wednesday morning, some people were getting annoyed by some of the posts of other people complaining on Facebook about their present situation of no heat and cold and no power and lack of good food. And I chuckled to myself when I saw someone post. They said, we know you have no power. We know you are cold. We know you are bored. What should you do now? Sit down and be quiet. And I'm not sure those were the most pastoral words that could be written, but I appreciated their sentiment. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that you are going to make it through this. Jesus said it a little bit differently in Matthew's gospel. Jesus said, do not worry. Look at the birds of the air. Are you of not a more value than they? And Jesus said, you see those flowers there and how beautiful they are? Won't the God who cares for you clothe you even more beautifully than they? Don't worry, said Jesus. God is with you. God has got this. Maybe it is just the wisdom that comes with age, but what I experienced over the course of this storm was younger folks freaking out and older folks just hanging out. We called around to a number of our older folks just to check on them, and they were fine. Some of them had gone to hotels, some had gone with kids, some were just hanging at home. And I'm guessing that they've had the wisdom of having lived through many storms, and they knew enough that this too shall pass. The power will come on. The house will warm up. It will be okay. One of the games we played while we were sitting in the cold darkness, I came up with a game was guess when the power would come on. And so we went around the room and some guessed in just a few hours and some were a little bit less optimistic. My disabled daughter, Sophia, who takes after me in many ways, she guessed never. It was never going to come back on. By Wednesday morning, I was beginning to wonder too, and I was getting frustrated and annoyed. I was cold. My 82-year-old dad was like, yeah, I'm okay. He put another blanket on himself. He said, announced everybody, he said, I slept better Tuesday night than I've slept in a long time. He said, y'all go on over to Molly's if you want to get a hot shower. I'm good. He said, the power will soon be on soon enough. There is great wisdom, I think, that comes from not getting caught up in the chaos that often comes in the wake of a storm. There is wisdom that comes from simply being quiet and being still. And allowing God to do God's work in God's time. No need to panic. No need to worry. God is still God. And we are not. God loves you. God cares for you. God wants the best for you. God is with you even when it doesn't feel that way. God will see you through the worst of storms, even through that storm called death. For with God, even in a dark, cold grave,
there is peace and joy and a warm embrace that waits on the other side. Simply be still and know that I am God. So I'm curious, did this storm teach you anything? Go ahead and write it in the comment if you'd like. But those are the lessons from the storm that I got. And those are the lessons I'm going to try and live out in this new year that is filled with hope. Peace and amen. Again, let me just say thank you for all the gifts you give the life of our church that just allow us to do so much ministry in the name of Christ. And I think about the people who are able to weather this storm because of the ministry that you do, of the food that was given out on Sunday at the mobile ministry right before the storm, the wood that went out from our lumberjacks, the ministries that you do to keep folks supplied with the essentials that they need. They make a difference. And so thank you for all you do. Thank you for the gifts that you text in, that you give online, that you mail in, that just allow us to continue to try and be the hands and feet of Christ here in this community. Thank you for doing that. And then let me share this benediction with you. And then Clay will lead us into a song of praise. That we might go forth into this world in peace and be of good courage. Hold fast to what is good and render to no person evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted and support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor every person. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the powers of the Holy Spirit. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus, both now and forevermore. Amen.
Bring your tithe.